2 days before the 2020 election, the world learned from Axios' Jonathan Swan that then-President Trump had a plan to declare a premature victory, regardless of the election results. But it turns out Trump had been planning that strategy since at least July. Here's Vice President Pence's top White House lawyer and one of Trump's closest allies, Steve Bannon, in testimony played at today's hearing.
Mark had indicated to me that there was a possibility that there would be a declaration of victory within the White House that some might push for. And this is prior to the election results being known.
And what Trump's going to do is just declare victory, right? He's going to declare victory. But that doesn't mean he's the winner. He's just going to say he's the winner.
That revelation is not all that the former president is grappling with today. The U.S. Supreme Court rejected Trump's request that they intervene in the Mar-a-Lago documents fight with the Justice Department. Donald Trump's new company is also under scrutiny by New York's Attorney General. And Vice President Pence's former chief of staff, Mark Short, was seen testifying before a grand jury for the second time. So, how is Trump world reacting to all this horrible news for him? Let's bring in the author of Confidence Man, The Making of Donald Trump and the Breaking of America, New York Times reporter Maggie Haberman. I should say New York Times best-selling author, number one best-selling author, Maggie Haberman. Congratulations, Maggie. What are you hearing about how Trump is responding to all this abysmal news for him that played out today?
So a couple of things, Jake, because he doesn't tend to process these kinds of legal actions the way other people might, working backwards. The revelations by the committee, most of his folks are sloughing them off because they're trying to say these are old news, and it's not surprising. In terms of the subpoena for him, that is actually one of the things that has animated him. He's been talking to advisors about how, he would consider testifying if they would air it live, which is also not surprising. It seems hard to imagine the committee would go for that. What he is very focused on right now is the other investigations that could lead to criminal charges. And that is still where much of his energy is focused. And for whatever reason, he is very focused on this lawsuit that's coming up next week where he has to be deposed, where he's being sued for defamation by E. Jean Carroll, a woman who has accused him of rape. The developments around January 6th, he considers those baked in. Everybody else does not, but he does.
That's interesting. Do you think his lawyers would let him testify live? I mean, I can't imagine that. I mean, it might feel good for him, but I can't imagine that making him look sane, rational, reasonable. I don't see any scenario in which he ends up looking good there.
I think that it would be, I also don't see a scenario where he doesn't potentially get himself into a fraud situation when he's testifying under oath. And I think it would depend on which lawyers he is listening to, Jake. He has different lawyers in different cases, and he seeks them out for different things, and they are not always on the same page.
Well, right, that's the thing, because he would be under oath. Often when he testifies under oath, he just ends up saying, I don't recall, I don't recall, I don't recall, because he's being told by lawyers that he has to do that. But I don't think he would do that before the committee. I just can't imagine any attorney, although I don't know how he's picking his attorneys these days. It doesn't seem like he's exactly going to the Harvard Law Review. So do you think, I mean, among these lesser attorneys who are giving him advice these days, do you think somebody would actually tell him, go ahead, do that, that's going to be great?
At least one of his lawyers was sounding people out about the idea today of him testifying and agreeing to it as long as the committee would let him do it live. And so I certainly don't think they're all shutting him down. I do think that there are people who would be concerned about it for the same reason that his lawyers, when he was being investigated by Robert Mueller, the special counsel, were concerned about him meeting with Mueller and testifying, which Trump wanted to, and they did not want him to for the reasons you just said.
Today, testimony from Cassidy Hutchinson was played that gets specifically to Trump's mindset. Let's run some of that.
So he had said something to the effect of, I don't want people to know we lost, Mark. This is embarrassing. Figure it out. We need to figure it out. I don't want people to know that we lost.
So that was about the Supreme Court refusing to hear some of the crazy lawsuits that were being filed on his behalf. How much do you think was fear of embarrassment one of the motivating factors behind Donald Trump's refusal to publicly accept the election results? That he just, that was one of his biggest fears, being embarrassed.
I think that's one of them, Jake. I think this is somebody who spent a lifetime being raised by a man who, you know, taught him that being a loser is an incredibly fraught thing. You know, you need to be a killer. You need to win. And that was something that his father got into his head over and over and over again. And then he surrounded himself with people who would affirm that. And so losing an election was not something that he was going to admit. I will make the point. He said the election that he won was rigged, too, in 2016. This is something he says about elections. I do think a piece of it is about being embarrassed. I think part of it is also just refusing to accept reality on anyone else's terms but his own.
You heard us play sound of Greg Jacob, Pence's lawyer, detailing Trump's premeditated plan to declare victory on election night, regardless of what happened. The committee laid out evidence that it started as early as July, that plan. What does your reporting say on this, how long he was planning to just prematurely declare victory, even though he likely lost?
It's similar, Jake. He was telling people, some of his advisors, in July, and I have reporting on this, that he was going to, he was going to raise questions about the mail-in ballots and suggest, because remember, all of these rules changed around COVID in 2020 in terms of how people were allowed to vote, and he was going to say, that this was unfair, or this was wrong, or this was corrupt. And so he had been talking about this and working toward this for a very, very long time. And, you know, even Jonathan Swan and Axios reported, as you noted, he was the first to report that in October, Trump had stunned some of his advisors by just announcing he was going to go up there on election night and say he won no matter what. It was clear where this was headed.
Now, Maggie, Trump calling you his psychiatrist, what was your reaction to that? How do you see yourself?
I don't think that this was a line that he actually meant, Jake. It's the kind of thing that he, I think, says to intend to flatter. He has used it about any number of other interviewers or about his Twitter feed or about his rallies. The reality is that he treats everybody like they're his psychiatrist. He is working it out in front of all of us, his staff, his advisors, his rally-goers, his pseudo-friends and friends in real time.
And yet I have to acknowledge, and I say this as you know, not only a friend of yours, but an admirer of your reporting and your work ethic. He attacks you all the time, even though he obviously wants and craves your respect so much. He says things like this about you at rallies. Let's roll that shot.
Who's with the New York Times? I hope it's not Maggie Haberman or Parker, because they're not legit.
They don't know me. They don't know me. I haven't seen her. I haven't spoken to her in a year and a half.
Maggie Haberman gets a Pulitzer Prize. She's a third-rate reporter.
I mean, you're a fantastic reporter, and yes, you got the Pulitzer Prize covering him. What do you make of that? Because I think you and I both know he really wants you to approve of him.
He wants the New York Times to approve of him, and I just happen to be the person who covers him more than other people at this paper, and I knew him before he was a candidate, so I think that's part of it. But I really can't overstate how much his fixation on the paper drives this.
Do you think that you have a better understanding of him now that you've written this book? And I should note for people, like, the book does not start Inauguration Day 2017. It goes back to, like, his family, his roots, his father, Fred, who, no offense, sounds like a really awful dad to have. Do you think you understand him better now, having plunged into his background more for this book?
I think there are parts of him that I understand better than before. But, you know, the goal had always been, because I come from New York and I've covered New York politics and aspects of New York's various systems for a long time, the goal had always been to try to show the animating forces, which I understood before, about the world he came from and what shaped him and how he exported that to Washington, D.C., and to the White House, and then to the Republican Party, and it lives on in our politics. That had been the goal, and while I felt like I understood it previously, I think I have a richer understanding of certain aspects of it, yes.
Well, it's a really fantastic book, number one on the New York Times bestseller list. I recommend it to everyone, even if you think you already know everything you want to know about Donald Trump. It's really great. Congratulations, Maggie. Always good to have you on.
Jake, thanks so much.